Nik Collection's Color Efex has always been a favorite. Whether you're looking to simply refine your image with ease, apply one-click cool looks, or dive deep into making your image truly unique, Color Efex helps you get the job done. I have a photo shot on a sunny day in Budapest that just isn't quite giving me the vibes that I want, so let's see what we can do with it. Today, I'll be using Lightroom Classic as the host. The easiest way to open an image from Lightroom Classic into Nik Collection is to simply right-click on it and choose Edit In, and choose your plugin. Notice, however, that you can also open your image as a smart object in Photoshop. Opening an image as a smart object does give you the ultimate in flexibility, and to learn more about that, be sure to watch my Photoshop video. But for now, we're just going to go straight into the Nik Collection from here. I'll open it in Color Efex. And let's start with a quick tour of the interface. Over here on the left, we have all of our presets. There's a whole bunch of them, and whenever you click on one, it's going to apply all of the filters that it needs to make that preset over here on the right. If I choose another preset, it simply replaces the filters on the right with the ones that it needs for this preset. As you can see, there's a lot of different presets in here. It's a great way to find inspiration or just look for something cool that you might want to use. To reset your image, go down to the history and then click on original image. Now, instead of using presets, I'll go straight into the filters. These are all the different filters that you have available, and many of these were used to make each of the presets you just saw. To add any filter, simply click on it, and you'll see that that filter gets added to the right. Now here's a very important thing to know about Color Efex. If I choose another filter, let's say film grain, and I select it, you'll notice that it replaced the existing filter that was here. The first one I added is gone, and film grain has replaced it. If I want to add an additional filter, you don't just click on the filter name, you have to click on the plus next to it. So if I wanted to add fog to this, I click on the plus next to fog, and now both filters are added. To delete any one filter from the stack, you can click on the small X on the right-hand side of it. Now let's make this image something cool. I want to add a film look to it, so I'm going to go into the search tab and just type in film to see what I've got. There's a bunch of different film effects in here. There's film effects vintage and nostalgic, and these all look fantastic, but my favorite is here under modern branded. Here we have a variety of films to choose from that are designed to mimic actual film stocks. If you've shot any of these before, you might recognize the looks of them, but there's a lot of really nice ones in here. The list just goes on and on. I'm going to choose Fuji 800Z for this photo. The film effects is more than just a filter. If you look down here, you'll see that there's sensitivity to various colors. So for example, this has a lot of blue sky in the image. So if I take the blue slider and adjust it, it's going to change the sensitivity of the film to that particular color. Take it down, it gets darker. Take it higher, and it gets brighter. There's some red on that balloon, so let's take the red sensitivity and take that up or take that down. You can really go far adjusting the look of your image just with these sliders here. You can also adjust the tone curve if you want to give it a little bit more lift in the shadows or make them a little bit crunchier. That's totally up to you. There's even grain in here. Keep scrolling down and you'll find the grain setting. And right now it's set to grain per pixel at a number of 404. To really appreciate what the grain looks like, you need to zoom in to 1:1. And now as I take my grain slider and I drag it down, adding less grain per pixel, the grain becomes more and more visible. I like a grainy image, but that's a bit much, so let me drag it back up to right about there. Anytime you want to compare the original image to what you've got now, you have three different ways to do it. I can click and hold on the compare button. I can click the split screen, and then I can even drag the slider back and forth to compare. Or I can do a side-by-side comparison. We're off to a pretty good start, but now I want to add some contrast to the building itself. So let's find the Pro Contrast filter. Instead of searching for it, I'll just scroll through, and there it is, Pro Contrast. Click plus to add that. Now, I don't want to add contrast to the entire image. I really want to focus just on the building itself. So how am I going to mask out the building? Well, down here under Local Adjustments, you have a variety of different tools to select just the part of the image you want to edit. And in this case, I'm going to choose to add the new color mask. I click to select it, and then click on any color of the image to create a mask based off of that color. Of course, we can't see anything yet, so to see what the mask looks like, click on the mask preview button, and you'll see what you've created. If I grab this point and drag it around the scene, you'll see that it's creating a mask in real time based off of whatever color it's over. If I drag it to the sky or to the red of the balloon, it'll make a mask based off of that. But again, I wanted the building, so I'll find an area to select that gets most of the building. It's not quite got all of it yet, so let's see what else I can do. Down here you have the mask options, and you'll see on these sliders that it's based the mask off of this range of colors that is actually quite narrow. However, I can manually expand that. Just click the little handle here and drag it out, and that'll expand the mask. And you'll see if I get too big, it'll start to include everything else in the scene. And if I make it too small, it'll include very little. So from here, I can adjust this to find just the right amount to create the mask that I want. I can also feather the mask. And you may have noticed that as I adjusted one side, the other side adjusted as well, but I can unlink that with this button here. And now drag these out however I want independently to get the perfect mask. That's definitely got most of the building covered, so we'll leave it there. With the Pro Contrast filter that I added, there's a variety of different types of contrast. I would definitely encourage you to look in the user guide to see what each one of these does, or you can just play with them. But if you want to find the user guide, go up to the help menu and choose user guide. That'll launch a web page that has complete instructions of what all the different filters do. In this case though, I'll just play with them. I'll drag dynamic contrast up and see what that does. It's definitely adding some nice contrast and brightening up the shadows in the front here, which I quite like. And you can try the other ones and see if you want to combine them or if you like one over another. But for me, this dynamic contrast is going to do the trick. The last thing I want to do to this image is brighten up this tower here. This is looking a little bit dark and I just want to put a little extra light on it. So for that, I'll use a simple levels and curves, which is right here. Since I use this a lot, I'll also mark that as a favorite by clicking a star on it, making it easier to find. Click on plus, and there's levels and curves. Now, of course, I don't want to affect the entire image. I just want to affect that tower. So a pretty easy way to select that will be with a simple control point. I'll just drop the control point on there, size it over the tower, maybe rotate that a little bit. And with a quick preview, we can see exactly what mask we've created. That should do the job. Now I'll just raise that up a little bit. So it's doing a pretty good job of raising the brightness on there, but you'll notice how this tower seems to have gone a little bit green. Here's an important point when working with filters and color effects. The order of operation of the filters, meaning the order that they're stacked in, matters. If you put a black and white filter at the very end, it's going to make the entire image black and white. If you put it at the beginning and then add a color tint on top of that, it's going to add a color tint on top of the black and white. Take that black and white and move it to the end, and the whole thing goes black and white again. So this is an important thing to keep in mind when you're adjusting your image, especially when adding things like levels and curves, because where you add it could make a difference in how it's affected. Watch this. To make this easier to follow, I'm going to go ahead and collapse all of these. So we just have these three filters on here, and we're just looking at their titles. I'll take levels and curves and drag it to the top here before the film effects, and watch what happens to the tower here. As I do this, the color cast goes away. So the color cast was getting added somewhere in here that was then being amplified by levels and curves. But by moving it to the top, now that's gone and the image looks better. Color Efex is incredibly powerful and an absolute dream to work with. So many tools, so many options, and the masking is second to none. For more on Color Efex, be sure to watch the Photoshop video where you'll see even more capabilities and the most flexible way to work with Color Efex or any tool in Nik Collection 8.